she hasn't learned anything, she hasn't had a win or a loss, then there's no point to the scene. It's not really a scene. Hey guys, I'm Michelle. Welcome back to my channel. If writing workshops and traditional publishing talk are your thing, please consider subscribing. Today's video is the first in a two-part series that I'm going to create in response to questions that Sherry and Lindsay recently asked. Sherry said, "I'm struggling with summary versus narration. All my bits of summary sound pedestrian. Also with scene transition, particularly starting chapters with the next morning, they seem to all start like that. I find I'm also ending my chapters with internal dialogue. It's frustrating during revising to see these patterns that make the writing seem so predictable." And Lindsay said, "I'm going to second the question already posted on transitions. I'd also love something on how to go from the zero draft quality scene to an acceptable first draft scene. Tips on how to add meat on the bones of the story, as it were, and create a scene that feels real and visceral rather than flat." So today's video is going to focus on both of these things, primarily scene transitions and also just the basics of what makes a scene, because I think it's important to grasp that before you worry about finding new and creative ways to transition from one scene to another. And then next week's video, part two, is going to go more into the whole adding meat on the bones thing, as Lindsay put it, which is a great way of looking at it, because I think that's really important too in fleshing out your scenes. And as I'll talk about a little bit more later, I think it's really important to remember that everything I'm about to say, don't pressure yourself into getting this right the very, very first time you're writing your very first draft of this story. A lot of this is going to come in revisions. So let's start with talking about what makes a scene a scene. What makes a scene complete? It's not the setting. It's not whether the characters move from point A to point B, although they might move from point A to point B. And it's not the timeline. It's not an hour or a day or a week or a year. It can be any length of time. What makes a scene is the character's emotional state and how it changes. You've probably heard that every scene is like a mini story. It has its own structure. It has a rise and fall. Your character has a want or a goal. They go through a conflict or two, and they either get that goal or they don't get that goal, or they discover a whole new goal that they want. And most importantly, and the more simple way of looking at this, their emotional state changes. If your character starts a scene sad and lonely, and she ends that scene sad and lonely, and there is zero change in her emotional state, then it doesn't matter if that scene took place over the course of 1 hour or 1 week. It doesn't matter if she moved locations, if she went from her house to her job to the grocery store to the moon. It doesn't matter. If she feels the same at the end of the scene, she hasn't learned anything, she hasn't had a win or a loss, then there's no point to the scene. It's not really a scene. Whatever your process is, whether you're an outliner or a pantser or something in between, when you start to write a scene, ask yourself how your character's emotional state is going to change. If you need a little more guidance, go through all of these questions and answer each of them. How does my character feel at the beginning of the scene? Why does she feel this way? What does she want or not want as a result of this feeling? What action does she take? What obstacles does she face? Does she overcome them or not? Does she get what she wants or avoid what she doesn't want? How does she feel now? Let's look at examples from a published novel. Sherry, I know that you in particular are writing a mystery, so for my example, I chose All the Missing Girls by Megan Miranda. Let's take a look at the first few scenes, the emotional changes, and how Miranda transitions from one scene to the next. It started with a phone call, deceptively simple and easy to ignore. The main character, Nick, is in bed on a Sunday morning and sees her brother calling. She doesn't answer and wonders why he's calling. She listens to his message and gets some news about her dad and her childhood home. She ignores it, goes back to sleep, gets up, and has a normal day. And then later that day, still in her home, she looks through yesterday's mail and finds a letter with a mysterious message from someone she knows from her past, it's implied, about that girl. I saw that girl. She calls her brother back and tells him, "I'm coming home. Tell me what's going on." This scene is barely 2 pages long. It takes place in one day, in one setting. But look at the change in Nick's emotional state and the action that she took as a result. She started out ignoring her brother and her past, and then she ended up calling her brother and committing to returning to her home and her past. And this is a decision that Miranda makes it very clear in the prose is not something Nick wants to do. She resisted, and then she gave in, and that's what makes this a scene. Let's look at the next one.
I took inventory of the apartment one last time before loading up my car. So we've jumped ahead to her actually leaving. How long has it been? We found out down the page that a few weeks have actually passed. But the scene doesn't start with it a few weeks later. It starts with the moment Nick actually leaves, which flows nicely from the previous scene's last line of dialogue, "I'm coming home." When Nick lets us know how much time has passed, she gives us a good idea of her emotional state too. I'd gotten everything together in a rush, finishing out the last few weeks of the school year while fielding calls from Daniel and finding someone to sublet my place for the summer. No time to pause, to take in the fact that I was actually doing this. Going back. Going there. She's anxious. She's stressed. She hasn't fully processed what she's committed herself to doing. This scene is also really short. She says goodbye to her fiancé, Everett, and he says, "It'll go fast, you'll see," referring to the 2 months that she's going to spend back at home. She takes him in and memorizes the details of him, his steps crisp and measured, his dark hair brushing his collar. And when he goes, "The reality of the day suddenly makes my limbs heavy, my fingertips tingle." She's saying goodbye to her present and going to her past. And now the processing has really begun. The scene ends with her texting her brother that she might be slightly later than she'd intended, and as she's starting the car, he responds, "Dad's expecting you for dinner. Don't miss it." Like I might be 3 hours later than I'd claimed. That was one of Daniel's more impressive accomplishments. He had perfected the art of the passive-aggressive text message. He'd been practicing for years. This scene, not chapter, ends here. Not much time has passed, but Nick has moved from her apartment to her car. Again, it's the emotional state that matters. Nick goes from being too rushed to process her homecoming to actually leaving and letting it sink in. Goodbye, fiance. Hello, passive-aggressive brother. And on that note, the transition to the flashback that makes up the next scene feels natural. When I was younger, I used to believe I could see the future. After several pages of hints about Nick's obviously conflicted relationship with her brother Daniel and their father, we're finally about to get some backstory, and it makes sense that these thoughts would occupy Nick's mind as she makes this drive. She remembers back when she daydreamed about her and Tyler, an old boyfriend, we assume, leaving for college and leaving for good. It was impossible to understand back then that getting out wouldn't be an event in a pickup truck, but a 10-year process of excision, miles and years slowly padding the distance. She compares leaving to climbing a ladder, and her hometown is the bottom rung. When her fiancé asked her questions about her childhood, she gave non-specific answers, mentally saying her childhood was a Polaroid fading from the edges in, the colors bled out, the outline of a ghost town full of ghosts. But then the call from her brother with the news that they had to sell the house got those memories surfacing about her mother and a girl named Corrine. Also, some more memories about that boyfriend, Tyler. The final line of the scene, "That girl," my dad wrote, and her laughter rattled my heart.
Aha! So this flashback scene not only gives us a change in Nick's emotional state, there's also a few reveals. Nick has put a lot of work into distancing herself from her hometown and her childhood, not just physically, but also mentally and emotionally. And that nice little reveal at the end of the scene that it was Dad who wrote that letter about that girl tells us why Nick really made this decision and why she's going home. It's not about her brother, and it's not about her dad, at least not entirely, and it's not about selling the house. It's about that girl, Corrine. Her laughter rattled my heart. The change in emotional state here is that Nick has been suppressing some feelings we don't know about this girl, Corrine, ever since she left her childhood and her hometown behind, and now something has shaken them loose and they're rising to the surface. Now, as far as getting more into scene transitions, here's the workshop activity that I have for you today. pull one of your favorite novels off your bookshelf and start looking through the scenes and identifying how the character's emotional state changes from the beginning to the end of the scene, and just look at the different ways that the author chose to begin and end each of their scenes, and how do they transition from one scene into the next. Does it begin or end with dialogue, with internal dialogue? Is it the narrator making a statement to the reader? Is it a description of the setting or of another character? Let's use this book again and just flip through and see some of the different variety of ways that Miranda started and ended her scenes.
Let's start with beginnings. Gossip, the most dangerous part of an investigation. Here we have the narrator's statement of opinion to the reader. Come on. I had to pull Everett toward the car. He was solidly past his tipping point. So this one starts with dialogue and action. The teenagers scattered throughout the clearing were finally asleep, and I carefully wove through their campsite, stepping over empty cans and sleeping bags, heading for the narrow path to the caverns. Dawn was already breaking through the trees, the sky pink and hazy, but darkness beckoned from the entrance of the caverns. So this one starts with setting description and also gives us an idea of the time of day. Now let's look at some endings. I hung up when Tyler's voicemail picked up and I started searching. I searched the house for skeletons. I had to get them. I had to get them first. So this scene ends with the character getting a new mission or a new goal. Her cold hands at my elbows, her breath in my ear, Bailey's laughter tight and nervous in the background, the scent of Corrine's spearmint gum, her fingers dancing across my skin. Jump, she said. She told me to jump. I'd call this a cliffhanger ending because that last line begs the reader to ask, did you? I imagine they questioned her, and I imagine she confirmed our story because they never asked again. Annalise had been our alibi. This one is a plot reveal. It was coming with a vengeance, like the leaves in the fall, turning colors in warning, and then, with a strong wind, they all fall down. So this chapter ends with simile and also a little bit of foreshadowing.
So I mentioned that this is going to be a two-part video, and next week's will be more about that summary versus narration and going from zero draft to first draft and putting meat on the bones of your story. I really believe that this and scene transitions, this is all really tied together, because writing a great scene with clear emotional changes and great scene-to-scene transitions, that is not something that's going to happen in your first draft or your zero draft or whatever it is that you want to call the very first version of this book that you write. You might have a lot of really great scenes in your first draft, but you're going to have a lot of info dumping, you're going to have a lot of awkward transitions, and that's all completely normal. The thing is though, they're going to drive you nuts if you let them. So just remind yourself that it's okay for a lot of this story to be really clunky and messy for now. Maybe not all your scenes feel like they have a point quite yet. Maybe you just don't know how to transition from this chapter to this chapter and you just absolutely hate that part of the book and it bugs you every time you look at it. That's okay. You just have to get the story out and then come back to this video and go through those questions I asked at the beginning about your character, and apply that to every single scene. Take a closer look at the way you start and the way you end every single scene in the revision process. And how you do that is gonna be what part two next week is gonna be all about. So that is it for this video. I really hope you found this helpful. If you did, please don't forget to hit that like button. I will see you guys on Friday with another vlog, and until then, keep writing.